und herzlich willkommen zum M495 Musikinterview. Heute mit einer ganz besonderen Legende, nämlich Ian Hill, dem Bassisten von keiner geringen Band als Judas Priest. Hi Ian, thank you for taking your time and welcome to Munich.
Oh, thank you very much, appreciate that.
How do you do and how's the tour going so far?
I'm doing well and so is the tour. It's going really, really well, you know. We've, you know, it's on the back of a great album as well, you know, and I think people have, I don't know, people are getting the buzz again and people wanted to come out to see shows and things. It's the one thing these days that you can't replicate is, yeah, is a live show, you know. You get loads of things on sort of, people have, you know, but it's not real, is it, you know. And it's going really, really well, going really well.
And the tour in Munich was sold out extremely fast.
It did?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great news. We did, see, learn something every day. Nobody told us that. That's great.
On your last concert, there was Glenn Tipton joined you on stage. Yeah. And he had to leave Judas Priest due to his Parkinson's disease. How was he doing on stage?
He was doing all right. Glenn's out with us at the moment. He's travelling with us.
Yeah.
And some nights he feels well enough, he'll come up on stage and he'll play the encores or the
problem.
Gaff.
I'm glad it's not my cell phone. Yeah. I would have been ashamed. It's okay.
Yeah, he plays when he can, yeah, you know. He's doing about as well as anybody can, given his situation. And if anybody can beat it, it'll be him. He's a street fighter, he's Glenn, yeah, you know, he's tough. And like I say, it was a terrible thing, you know, it really was. I mean, none of us can really imagine what he's going through. His body's told him he can't do it anymore. He hasn't done anything stupid. He hasn't fallen off a boat or crashed a car or, yeah, or drugged himself to death or anything like that. He just can't do it, he's terrible, you know. And everybody's heart goes out to him, but he does it when he can. We can't promise anything,
yep,
because I don't want somebody going buying a ticket to the show on the strength of seeing Glenn and him not showing up, because they'll be disappointed. But he does it when he can, you know. He when he's feeling fit enough, he comes out and he's great. It's great to have. He gets a great, great reception, obviously, when he walks out, sure, on stage, you know. So we'll see maybe tonight, you know.
Okay, so it's not even quite sure whether he will play or not. He will decide it in the last minute?
He's here and he's feeling great at the moment.
Okay.
So it's looking great.
Okay. We're looking forward to it. It's not the first time a musician gets replaced in Judas Priest. For example, in the 19th, Rob Halford got replaced by Tim Ripper Owens. Mm-hmm. And in 2011, Richie Faulkner got replaced by longtime member K.K. Downing. Yeah. So, for example, Richie Faulkner is a rather young musician in comparison to your age. I guess he learns a lot from you, but is there anything you've learned from him and the young other members that joined and left Judas Priest all over the time?
Yeah, Richie's a great talent, he really is. He's a superb guitarist, and he's a great human being as well, you know. And obviously he's learning upon me. We have a lot of experience that we're doing our best to pass on to him.
Yeah.
But he's got... he's young and he's got lots of enthusiasm, lots of energy. I mean, if you remember when he joined, that was the Epitaph tour, and we were going to try and slow down. Of course, that didn't happen. I mean, Richie's always there. We've got to do this, we've got to do that, and of course, we would have missed it anyway if we'd have slowed down. But he's given us that. He's given us energy. Mm-hmm. And he's given us incentive and enthusiasm again. You know, not that we didn't have it before, but he's gave us, you know, a little bit of a nudge. And we're all determined now to keep going for as long as we can, you know. And we're loving it at the moment. Things are going great, you know. They really are.
I think people are noticing that you're really having fun on stage, and even on the album you can feel it. There is still a lot of energy.
Yeah, it was. The recording process was very enjoyable. We played through the songs live in the studio for the first time in donkey's years. And that was a suggestion from Andy Sneap. Mm-hmm. We used two producers on the album.
And who's with you on tour right now?
Andy ended up playing guitar, okay. Yeah. Because when Glenn had to admit to himself, really, that he couldn't, you know, do the whole show, we could see it. But he had to convince himself, you know. Andy was actually there. He was in the. He'd bought some backing tapes and some sound effects. And he just happened to be there, you know. I said, "Well, why don't you give Andy a go?" So we did, and Andy agreed, and he put some of his production work, mm-hmm. Rescheduled it so we could fit it in at the, you know, in one of the gaps in the tour. Mm-hmm. And he's doing great, you know. I mean, Andy's a great guitarist. He was a great fit because he's familiar with all the new songs. Mm-hmm. And half of learning something is when you know it.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's not easy, but at least it makes it easier. And he's also been a fan of the band for years as well, so he knows a lot of the older stuff, you know. So he was a great fit, you know. Mm-hmm. He's a perfect choice. And, of course, as the tour's going on, he's getting his confidence on stage as well. He's getting into his own technique and his own moves and things like that.
But he also has a lot of stage experience, isn't it?
Yes, he's well, obviously, he's been playing with bands for quite a while now, you know, for 20-odd years, as far as I know. So, yeah, he's got his own experience, his own stage experience. Yeah. You know.
Okay. Talking more of learning from young musicians, everybody's talking about older bands that influence their style. For example, most people say, oh, Black Sabbath, we got influenced by Black Sabbath. But often there are bands that got influenced by younger bands that say, wow, they're so got so fresh style, they got another point of view on music. Is there a band of a younger generation that shaped your sound as well?
We pick things up from everywhere. I mean, personally, I don't get a lot of time to listen to new music. And when we have time off, you just want to leave it alone for a bit, you know, and spend some time with the folks. But yeah, I can see that. I can see you know, a new band with a fresh idea coming along, and even subconsciously, it might go up there, you know. And you know, they've got a new angle on things, and yeah, it might rub off.
Can you name a band?
I can't, no, I can't. But there's bands over the years, you know.
Yeah.
But mainly the prominent bands. I mean, you can pick things up from anybody who's in your face or all the time, you know. And I'm sure that's happened. I mean, I don't write the songs, you know. Obviously, Rob and Glenn and now Richie are the main songwriters. So, I should imagine that they have maybe picked up a little bit, like, subconsciously.
Yeah, it is. Okay, Judas Priest were the leaders of new wave of British heavy metal, or still are, and you had a huge influence on some bands of the thrash metal genre, like Slayer, Metallica, Megadeth, with whom you were on tour as well. Mm-hmm. And now Slayer are going to say farewell and doing their farewell tour. Is it like you thinking, man, we are still here, or is it like, okay, they quit, we are giving it more power than ever?
Yeah, they're quitting all the wings, I don't know. God, kids today. No, Slayer have had a great run, they really have. We love them to death, we're great admirers of Slayer. And we've worked with them over the years, you know, quite a few times, in fact, you know, bumping into each other on festivals. Mm-hmm. They've, you know, been on tour with us as well for two or three occasions, I believe. And they've probably decided their time's come, you know. I can't speak for them. I don't know the reasons that they're quitting, but like it's obviously a good time for them, you know. So good luck to them, you know. We love them to death.
And you keep it going on.
We're going to keep going. We're still loving it, you know.
That's what I wanted to hear.
Yeah. We intend to carry on. Yeah.
Okay. I wouldn't have accepted another answer.
No, good.
Okay. You're now the longest lasting member in Judas Priest, with almost 50 years. After all the struggle that the band had over the years, lots of struggles and peak members coming and going, but where do you get all your patience from?
Oh, I'm an easygoing chap, always have been. Very rarely get angry, you know. Yeah, I've got a lot of patience, I'm very easy. But for the most part, it's been a great run, it really has. I've enjoyed everything, all of it. Even right back to the early days. I mean, we were talking to someone earlier on, to some of the Sony guys who were here, about the first times when we came to Germany, you know, mm-hmm. playing like the old Zoom Club in Frankfurt and places like that. And we'd sleep in the van. We'd just come over in the van, put all the gear in the van, put your mattress on top of the gear, and that's where you slept. And if you wanted to, you know, if you wanted to bathe, you went to the public baths and you had a shower at the public baths. Yeah. We did that for ages, you know. You think about it now, and it's like, we really couldn't do that, you know. But at the time, it was like one big adventure, and it was great. So, you know, so I've loved all of it. And then there's the big 80s years, you know, where we were playing in front of a lot of people, you know, when heavy metal was very popular. That was good as well, you know, and we're still loving it now. It's just been a great ride, the whole thing.
And that's what keeps you going on.
Well, yeah, you know, we love it, we're capable to do it, and people want us to do it. So why not? If there ever becomes a time when we can't put a quality show on, well, we'll start thinking about, you know, slowing down again. But
well, no.
But that's not happening at the moment, you know. We're out here loving it. We put
in a time far, far away.
Yes, far, far away. Yeah.
And did the chemistry of Judas Priest somehow changed, in your opinion, over all the years?
Not the basic chemistry, no. Even now, you know, with two different guitarists, it's still recognisably Judas Priest. Mm-hmm. So the basic chemistry, I mean, we have changed directions a little here and there over the years, but it's basically remained the same. We've just got this one mantra, which is for each album, each cycle, album, tour, try and make it better. Yeah. That's all we've ever done, you know. And it's kept us fresh. I mean, we're nearly 50 years old. We're having the best chart position we've ever had, you know, in here in Germany, in the States, and all over the place, you know. So we've been able to keep ourselves fresh and relevant, and not just concentrate on old glories and just keep on going out and rehashing the old chestnuts, you know. And we intend to carry on doing that, you know.
Talking of relevance, for example, it's the first time since the 50s that rock and roll isn't the best-selling genre anymore. Nevertheless, your album's getting more popular with every release, and now your 18th and newest studio album, Firepower, reached the top 10 in quite a lot of countries. Yeah. How do you explain this to yourself in this kind of power that you still got?
I don't know. It's a strong album, you know. As soon as I heard the rough demos, you know, Glenn and Richie and Rob will get together and put the songs together. When they've got an album's worth, they'll do a bunch of roughs, and Scott will get a copy and I'll get a copy, bass lines and drum patterns. And as soon as I heard the roughs, you know, I thought, this is pretty darn good. And of course, with the producers as well, they had a huge bearing on the overall sound of the album. And we get up there and perform. It's them that make it sound the way it does, you know. And they've done a tremendous job together with Mike Exeter, of course, the great engineer. And it turned out great. It turned out really, really good. And I think it started a buzz. I mean, some of the songs on there are quite commercial, you know, mm-hmm. comparatively anyway. And radio stations started picking up. And, of course, it creates interest, all this stuff, you know. And the tour's doing great. We did some record business in the American leg. We're doing great business on the European leg now, you know. We've got some more stuff coming up as well, you know, and it's all looking great. What it is, I don't know. Maybe people are just getting a little bit tired of the manufactured stuff that's rammed down the throat every day, you know, the same 40 songs played all day for a week. Maybe people are just getting tired of that and looking for something different. I don't know.
Okay. Next year you are going to face the 50th anniversary of Judas Priest. Are there any plans to celebrate?
I dare say we will be celebrating. It's a bit early days yet. We're still concentrating on what we're doing now. But we'll pull something special out of the bag somewhere.
Okay. Thank you, Ian, for taking your time, and it was a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you.
It's been great. Pleasure.
Thank you.